name is Jenny Morgan, and I'm one of the co-pastors here at Highlands Church. And I get to greet you this morning with the words of our ethos. This is kind of a statement that shapes what we mean by justice in our community. Married, divorced, or single here, it's one family that mingles here. Conservative or liberal here, we've all got to give a little here. Big or small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt or believe here, we all can receive here. LGBTQ or straight here, there's no hate here. Woman or man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us, grace here. In imitation of the ridiculous love Almighty God has for each and every one of us, we try to live in love without labels. Amen? Well, together we make up the living, breathing body of Christ on earth. We've coined this phrase, ecclesia symbiotica, to describe what it means to be connected relationally to one another and to our vision for the future. Ecclesia, it's like imperfect people learning together to follow and worship Christ. And symbiotica, it's like imperfect people living together in symbiosis, mutually interdependent on one another and ultimately dependent on God. So, as we slowly move toward maturity and spiritual health in Christ, we see that our growth together thrives in vibrant relationships. The letter to the Ephesians in the Bible creates a great framework for how we see ecclesia symbiotica. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other and tender-hearted. Forgive one another as quickly and thoroughly as God in Christ forgave you. Watch what God does and then do it, like children who learn proper behavior from their parents. Mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with God and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. Christ's love was not cautious, but extravagant. Christ didn't love us in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us. Love like that. Love like that. We're supposed to be imitators of God. What a vision for love. How do we love like that? What would it be like if we all had a vision for each other? What if we could look one another in the eye and envision something beautiful beyond what we see with our eyes, into what God sees? Ecclesia symbiotica. Grounding for that kind of love comes from the image and likeness of God imprinted in life everywhere. Early in the Bible, Genesis cries out, God created human beings in God's very own image, male and female, created to reflect the image of God embedded in each one of us. Today we suggest one practice to help us see each other the way God sees, the relational, prayerful practice of believing the best in each other. It's a commitment that our leaders in this church make to one another, and they work toward this ecclesia symbiotica vision for reality. Believing the best in each other doesn't require that we always like each other, and it doesn't require that we always agree, but it's a practice that does require our deepest intention to love the way Christ loved us. Learning to believe the best in each other, like any intention, like any vision, needs prayerful imagination. Fueled by God's Spirit, this prayerful imagination allows us to reach across differences and across hurts and believe the best in each other, whether we see the best or not. Now, at odds with believing the best are all these things that the passage in Ephesians begins with. Things like blaming and bitterness and anger and rage toward each other and slanderous language that we might use to describe each other, like resentment that's harbored over a long period of time. Judgmentalism implies that we really don't believe the best in each other. Like, I judge your way as wrong, or not as good as my way, And that judgment lets me think more highly of myself. Last week at band rehearsal, before the worship service, a few of our musicians were late. I shall name no names. But the lateness got us talking about whether or not we tended toward being late or being on time for meetings, for church, for dinner, for work, for rehearsals, for anything. It got me thinking that one group of people can easily feel judgmental or shaming to a group of people that behaves differently than them. The people who tend to be early to band practice can feel superior toward the people who tend to be late. And there's a judgment. It generates a knot in your stomach if you're the person or the people who tend to be on time. Those folks feel disrespected. They feel dismissed somehow, like their time isn't valuable enough for somebody to be there with them on time. And the behavior of those who are late makes it hard for the early people to believe the best in the late people. How do we believe the best in people when we don't like their behavior? When we don't like their character? When we don't like their beliefs? When we don't like their politics? When we don't even like their haircut? Believing the worst is way easier than believing the best. It's easier to say that you're good and your way is worthy if you can prove that someone else is worse than you. Like it's a false fabrication of my self-image, or an ongoing bolstering up of a frail sense of who I am. These comparisons soon become about who is worthy and who is not worthy. Like, who is in and who is out? Who is late and who is not? You were on time. Our passage today begins with this short list of what to avoid in our relationships. There are relational habits to be broken. But more importantly, I have to learn to release an inner sense of self that is wrongly perceived as better or more or righteous when I compare myself to somebody else. We have to cut ties with all of these comparisons. We have to cut ties with the bitterness and the gossip and the cutting people down. Ephesians says, end these habits. The passage is short on what it prohibits and long on what it asks of us. We're asked to practice, to make a habit of love. So we have to rehearse the right relational connections, or we'll tend towards self-indulgence. Learn a life of love by practicing believing the best in each other. If you shadowed me for a day, I am sure you would find it hard to believe the best in me. But I'd be great practice. I'd be great practice for you. To begin practicing this habit of believing the best in each other, let's sort of kick our imagination a bit. I want you to imagine your kid at his worst, maybe around the age of 2.5, or in some cases, 16. We want to believe the best in our kids. Every parent does, every aunt does, every grandfather does. But it can be challenging when they don't behave the way we want them to. Believing the best can seem impossible when our kids are at their worst. Or imagine an aging parent who is no longer able to even come close to being their best. Or imagine a lifelong friend wounding you with an unexpected, thoughtless word that violates a trust between you. How do we believe the best when we've been insulted or hurt or wounded or somehow dismissed? Well, God thinks we can do this. Ecclesia Symbiotica reminds us that the image and likeness of God is in us. When we believe the best in someone, we're acknowledging the image of God inherent in that person and inherent in us. God asks us to love like that. And God demonstrates love like that in Christ. So we're to imitate Christ by believing the best in each other. And don't be misled. God is not naive. right? God knows my flaws. God knows your flaws. God knows our unrighteous state. God knows we've fallen short of the glory for which we were intended. God knows we all fall down. God knows that we at times live separated from the best that God intends for us. God knows we're sometimes late. And God still believes the best in us. God is stubborn in the belief that Christ's image embedded in each one of us and embedded in us as a community is stronger than we are. So when I feel angry with someone, let's just say, for example, Mark did, which happens occasionally, I have to kind of go inside myself and not allow my anger to take me down a path that I know is not really Mark Tidd. So I remind myself of who I know him to be, the image of God in him that I trust and that I have seen alive and strong in this man. I may still have to deal with my anger toward him or my disappointment or in some way that he might hurt me. But I can't let my anger fuel lies about someone that I choose to love. Someone who's really not actually that hard to love. And it's my responsibility, not his, for me to express my anger to him or my disappointment in him. And then we have to work it out together. And truthfully, we do. It's often sort of clumsy, like two people who don't quite know how to dance, but they want to dance together. But the bottom line basis is, we believe the best in each other, no matter what. God believes that in us too, because God believes in the newness that is in each one of us. Whether that newness is visible at any given moment or not, 2 Corinthians 5 says, if anyone is in Christ, that person is a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. We are new creations. It's true. That's God's vision of reality for us. And so God believes the best in us. We are defined by God and God's image in us rather than by our past or our ongoing flub-ups. The reason God believes the best in us is that God has this grand vision for each one of us. We were created in the image of God. The divine image literally resides in us, in Christ. Every last one of us is a new creation. So it gets a little bit simpler at this point. We imitate God because we are uniquely made in the express image of God. We believe the best in a flawed brother or sister because we trust the divine image in them. Every created thing reflects God's image. Rocks and trees and skies and seas and floating clouds and rustling grass, spiders and snakes, slugs and worms, and every starry, starry night you've ever seen. They all reflect something of the beauty and the likeness of God. But we humans have something different. We have the breath of God's Spirit in us. The image of God embedded in our very nature. 2 Corinthians says it this way. We all, with unveiled faces, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into that same image from one degree of glory to another. This amazing transformation is happening in us. Whether we can see it or not, it's happening. God is in us. God's glorious image is in every person. And that's why we are to believe the best in each other. And this is not just a nice idea. We don't want you to go home thinking, wow, that's pretty cool. That's a nice idea. You see, every human being has this glory in them. It's what's unique about us. God made us in God's image, and we must learn to see one another the way God sees us. In love, God calls the best out of each of us. All along the way, the timeline of our lives, God is calling the best out. And the best sometimes blossoms, and then it fails. And then it's reborn again, and then it dies. And then it's resurrected again, and all along the way, God believes the best in us. Always. Back to Ephesians. We are to forgive each other as quickly and thoroughly as God in Christ forgave us. We are to watch what God does and then do it like we were children imitating our parents' behavior. Mostly what God does is love us. So we keep company with God and learn a life of love. We are to observe how Christ loves us. Christ's love was not cautious, it was extravagant. Caution would lead us to believe the worst in each other. Extravagance leads us to believe the best. Extravagant love took Jesus to the cross. And extravagant love resurrected Jesus from the dead. Extravagant love demonstrates for us that God indeed believes the best in every one of us. Believing the best is an expression of love, and it requires faith. Not faith in each other so much as faith in God and faith in God's image in us. But it does not require perfection on the part of the person you're trying to love. Believe the best or believe the worst. And there's another option here. It's a terrible option. The option would be that we dismiss one another as flawed, and therefore we're not worth it. This is how people walk away from each other. Like you can hear it sometimes. You failed again, so I'm done with you. You're late, so I'm through with you. I expect nothing from you now. That's when we give up on each other. And God never does that. You never hear those words coming from God's mouth. God would never say, I'm done with you. I'm giving up on you. I'm going away. Actually, I don't think it's possible for God to say that. Because God is willingly confined by God's love. A familiar passage from the Bible, 1 Corinthians 13, describes this fierce love of Jesus Christ, a love that lived among us in order to lead the way for us. Love bears the weight of all things, 1 Corinthians says, believing, hoping, enduring all things. So no matter what I say, no matter what I believe, no matter what I do, I am bankrupt if I don't learn to love. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love always looks for the best. Love believes the best no matter what. And maybe that sounds crazy to you. I mean, we let each other down at times. We sometimes even disappoint the people that we love well. None of us is yet at our best. And I think we move toward our best by practicing this habit of believing the best in each other. It's like we have to agree with God. That's what faith is. We agree with God that in the other person lies the image and likeness of God. So I'm going to push the pause button for a second, because to tell you the truth, I have really struggled with this concept of believing the best in each other this week. And maybe you struggle with it too. So I want to take a second and have us let each other off the hook just a little bit before we move forward. So if right now, in your mind, you're thinking of anyone other than yourself learning to believe the best in another person, you might be missing the point. I can say that because I've spent the whole week missing the point. Like, I fixated on the lady who sent me a nasty email earlier this week. I thought a lot about the guy who subtly but earnestly manipulated me. It's so darn easy to point the finger and say, she's not believing the best in me. He should get in line because the Bible says so. But the point is, I am to practice believing the best in you and not require that you work harder to believe the best in me. Practiced love that learns to believe the best does not ignore bad behavior or abuse. So don't hear me that way. We aren't being asked by the Bible or by God or by each other to blindly believe the best. Rather, it's really important that we use prayerful discernment and the necessary conversation with the right person, never slipping into gossip. And as we engage in these hard conversations, the posture we take, is that we still believe the best in each other. We trust that God's image is in a person. So pause button's still on. If you're thinking of a person who should come to you because they have hurt you or offended you or somehow dismissed you, oh, I'm sorry. That's also not the point. Right? Like, you can't expect anyone to read your mind. I can't expect anyone to read my mind either. So I have a little flair for the dramatic. And when my partner has hurt me, or not met an expectation I have, I sulk. Like, I'm really good at sulking. And in those moments, I actually think that she should just know that I'm hurt. She should just be aware that I'm angry, that she's somehow done something that has pushed me away. I even think that she should chase me down. She should find me and know exactly what to say to make me feel better. Adult relationships in the body of Christ just don't work that way. Remember, we're responsible to one another, but not for one another. So when I feel hurt, I'm responsible to go to the person who has hurt me. We're called by God to take full responsibility of ourselves as we learn to love someone well. We're not in charge of measuring anyone else's capacity to love except our own. So, pause button off. Jenny Morgan is learning to love like Christ ever, ever so slowly. Christ's response to us, thank God, is not dependent on our behavior or our beliefs or our character. When Jesus responded to the disciples 2,000 years ago, and when God responds to us now, God is responding to the very image of Christ in us. As flawed as we may be, God sees far beyond our brokenness, straight through, right into what we were truly made for. Ecclesia Symbiotica. Near the end of John's Gospel, Jesus encounters Peter and asks Peter three times in various ways, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter was the one who denied Jesus. Actually, Peter three times blatantly renunciates Jesus, denying that he even knew Jesus. "Peter, Peter, do you love me?" Well, Peter had lied. He had lied during Jesus' greatest hour of need. When Jesus most needed a friend, an advocate, a brother, Peter said, "I don't know him at all." Jesus was on the way to his death, a death he claimed was on behalf of Peter and every one of us. Then after rising from the dead, Jesus went and found Peter and demonstrated what it means to believe the best. "Peter, Peter, do you love me?" Peter, who had disowned Jesus, could have been destroyed by a few caustic remarks out of the mouth of Jesus. For example, "You left me. You violated the trust of our relationship. Peter, you're a coward." Those statements are actually accurate about Peter. But the truth, without vision, may not be true at all. The truth, without vision, might not be true. Jesus knew the image of God in Peter. Jesus knew the truth, the deepest truth about Peter. Jesus knew God living and growing in Peter, the divine imprint on that man. Jesus believed the best in Peter, and so he said, "Peter, do you love me?" Jesus knew him and loved him. Jesus had a vision for him. Jesus called that vision out by believing the best in Peter. And this habit of love doesn't exhaust God. Not even close. God's love never runs dry. It's the nature of God to love everything that God created, to believe the best in us no matter what. So for Peter and for us, having Christ believe the best in you is what can give you the vision to believe the best in someone else. Love like that is foolish, but it's not uninformed. In other words, it's not naive. Love like that It's vulnerable, but not fragile. Love like that is strong, but not bravado. So we're to follow on the heels of Jesus and practice loving one another by believing the best in each other. And this love is not contingent on our behavior, on our beliefs, or on our character. Christ didn't love us in order to get something from us. Christ loved us to give everything of himself to us. Love like that. Through Christ's love for us, God transforms us. Being loved by God is the way love leaks freely out of us, as if we are full to overflowing with a love that changes us. This is the beauty of the Trinitarian God, the deepest source of constant, enduring love. Believe the best in each other. Love like that. Let's pray. We call on you, Trinitarian God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Creator, Jesus, and Spirit of God. Help us to love like that. Thank you that you really do believe the best in us. Thank you that you showed us extravagant love. Help us to follow in your footsteps. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, Jesus was a Jew, but Jesus was not a Jewish mother. So, when he was celebrating the Last Supper with his disciples, his attitude and posture was not one like, you know, after all I've done for you, now I gotta die. Little thanks would be, you know. There was no air of whining with it. It was that pure and raw demonstration of extravagant love that on the night that he was betrayed, denied, and the Gospel of Matthew said they all deserted him. So it wasn't just Judas. It wasn't just Peter. They all left him later on. It was that night that he showed what happens when you believe the best. And when you act in accordance with the best that you know is possible in people who will soon betray the trust, but it doesn't make it not true that they are better than their worst actions. It was extravagant love when Jesus had dinner with his friends, took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Every time you eat it, remember me." And likewise, after the supper, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he said, "This is the cup of a new covenant I make with you. My blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this, remember me." And we've been eating and drinking for a couple thousand years now, remembering that we are the beloved, that God doesn't abandon us as the sum total of all that's wrong with us, but embraces us, knowing that we have the imprimatur of God. God's love is pressed into us and runs throughout us. It courses through our veins, and we are the beloved. And I'd ask the servers to come forward, and as the communion servers come forward, I'd love for you to think about what that vision might be that God has of you, because he holds you in very high regard. He believes the best in you because he knows what's in you. He doesn't just keep an account of what you've done that's been naughty or nice. He believes the best in you, and he knows it's true. So this time where we get to relish in extravagant love. There will be communion servers on both sides, and they'll hand you a piece of bread or a gluten-free cracker if you need it, and you can dip it in the cup. There are other ways that you can use this time. There are prayer journals or question journals up at this front table. There are also ways to offer our prayers. We have little card droppers. We're not allowed to have open candles in the high school. So for the time being, we're using drops of paint and making collages of our prayers that we offer to God. So you're welcome to any of those. Or if this is a time where you just want to stay in your seat and consider what you've heard and what you've seen, you're free to do that. But know that you are the beloved and you're covered with an extravagant love.
Thank you.